So I shared the previous video with you. Did you get the video?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So by the previous lecture that we met at last time, so we finished the section on C programming part. That means I gave you a very good introduction to basics of C programming. So that is essential for operating system programming, right? So from today onwards, what we will be discussing is another section, which is how to interact with the operating systems in point of view through file system, right? How to read and write from a file, how to read to a, read from a file, and how to write to a file. So we, in the first, very first lecture, you had some introduction on how to use the Linux utilities for doing this. For example, in the first lecture, you had some exposure to reading and writing to a file using basic Linux terminal commands such as copy, cp, or cat command. Using the cat command and cp command, you saw how a file can be copied to another file. And also using the change mode command, you saw how the privileges assigned for a given file, which is residing in the operating system, could be changed, how those file permissions for different users could be changed. So there are inbuilt functions or utilities for doing that. But what we will be doing is how we can use system calls. So what are system calls? They are nothing but a kind of a software interrupt. So you know what is an interrupt. So that is a kind of interruption in the form of an instruction for software interrupts, which is going to interrupt the current execution of the process and allow what is going to be called by that interrupt. So in today's lesson and for next week also, we will be using system calls or interrupts to interact directly with the operating system and do those file input and output operations, right? So there are also inbuilt system calls which have already been defined for doing this input and output. So these are low level system calls. So if you take a Linux command like cp, so that is a kind of a big function or a big black box which contains a lot of those low level system calls and interactions. So what we will be doing today is we will use our C programming knowledge. We will use those C programming knowledge and write in C, some program for getting our task done. So what is our task? That is reading from a file and writing to a file, right? So that is the basic thing that we are going to perform, but we will be creating a program and use system calls for doing our task, right? So there are two set of functions called low level system calls and high level file input output system calls. So low level system calls were defined before those high level system calls were created. So first, so low level means it you have to define many things, right? In high level, the level of abstraction is high, such that you the programmer need not to know and input many parameters. I mean, the high level input output is easier than the low level input output. So as it is hard, first we will discuss the hard thing in today's lesson, and in next week we will go for the high level input output file input output system calls, right? So in today we will be discussing the low level model, right? So when we are using those system calls or those functions or interrupts, software interrupts, to interact with the operating system for file input and output, so those low level system calls are defined in these headers. So I hope you can see the screen, and so this universalstudio.h, this fcntl.h, this sysstat.h. So you need to include these header files in your programs in order to make these system functions identifiable to the GCC compiler. Otherwise, GCC compiler does not know from does not know the definition of those functions. Those are defined in these headers, and different functions are defined in different header files. And so we will need to include them in order to use the program. Otherwise, it will not be compiled properly. Right. So there is a definition called this file descriptor. So what exactly is a file descriptor? Is nothing but an integer value, right? So it is starting from 0 to a bigger number, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, likewise. There are integers. So so file descriptor is assigned to a file. So that is used to identify a file, right? So there are three file descriptors which are already assigned. So those are 0, 1, and 2. 0 is for the standard input. So what is a standard input in computer systems? It is the keyboard. That means the file descriptor 0 is assigned for the keyboard. Then the file descriptor number 1 is assigned for the standard output. Standard output is the display or the screen of your computer. So file descriptor 1 is always assigned to this one. And 2, file descriptor 2 is assigned for standard error. So standard error could be used to identify the error that had occurred, right? So the standard error is also usually printed on screen, or it may be printed to a file, that means written to a file. So you can use this standard error to identify the error occurred. And also, next, so we need to first open a file. So unless you open a file, you will not be able to read from file or write to file. So in the low level input output model, the corresponding function for opening a file is nothing but this open function. So it is a system call. So it will be acting as a software interrupt, right? So it is defined as like this, right? And it is defined in this header file. It is defined in this header file. So you need to have an understanding about what are the arguments of this open function and what is returned from this open function, right? So I have here said that it returns minus one on failure. So these input output calls, this low level model, so as the valid file descriptor begins from zero and increment one by one, so if you get minus one at any time, then that means it is an error, right? So in what is output from this open file is the file descriptor. So I told you that these are already assigned, and there may be another file descriptors which are already assigned by the operating system for performing different tasks. We don't know what will be the file descriptor which is going to be assigned, but it will be the highermost, I mean non empty, I mean empty, highest empty file descriptor. For example, assume that at some instant the file descriptors from 0 to 50 are already allocated, then if you call this open system call and you open a file, then what will be returning from this open system call upon success is 51. That means the file descriptor 51 is used to identify the open file, right? Such a thing is going to happen. So what is returned from this open function is nothing but the file descriptor, right? Okay, now we will consider about each and every argument of this open function. So those are important. So the first argument is called the path name. So path name is having the path to a file. So what is a path to a file? It is the location where the file is stored on your secondary storage. For example, see users desktop doc1.txt. So you can pass this path name in two modes. That is the absolute reference and relative reference. So what I just previously said was the absolute reference. So what is absolute reference? That is the exact path. See users desktop doc1.txt. That is the exact path, that is called the absolute path. And the other mode is the relative path. That is path relative to the present directory which this open system call is called. So you can, if you pass ./ doc1.txt, then that means look in the present directory for document doc1.txt. That is relative. When your present directory changes, that path also changes, right? So that is relative. So either way you can pass either a relative path or absolute path. So that is the path name. And then next, this is called flags. So what is actually should be passed is integers. The data type is integers. So what is contained in this flags is for what purpose this file is open, and the related privileges for open file. These are the arguments you can pass. So these are defined, right? So these are defined in this header, fcntl.h. So you need to include, if that's why you need to include fcntl.h. Otherwise, the programmer has to remember some integers. So it is difficult for a programmer to remember integers for these privileges. So there are a lot of things open for read only, open for write only, and you can open for both read and write. So if you specify or read write, so that is open for both reading and writing. That means you can, if you have the privilege, you can both read from file and write to a file, right? But in this mode, you can only write to a file, but you cannot read from file. In this mode, it is the other way. You can read from file, but you cannot write to a file. So these flags and these modes, you should remember. Right, I mean these flags you must remember, and don't forget to include this header file, right? Okay, and not only that one, you can you can use O operator. That's why I have given odd. You can use O operator in combination with this one, with one of these. I mean you can use this one for sure. And one of these. So what is this O create is, if the file is not exists. So which file? The file specified at this path name, if it does not exist, what you are trying to open, then we specifically say the operating system to create the file if it does not exist. Right? That's what it is meant by O create. If it exists, we can do one of these two. If it exists, we can either truncate the file or append the file. So what is truncating? It is, if it is existing, when you now open it, the previous content of the file will be deleted. If the file previously contained something, some information or some data, it will be deleted. That's what you mean by truncating. Or else you can use append. That means it will not, if the file exists, and it will not delete the content, but you can add content at the end of that file, end of the previous content, right? So you can either delete an existing file and open as a new file, or you can keep the existing file and add at the end of that file. So that's what you mean by appending, right? So these things are easy to remember. That's why they have been defined in this fcntl.h for the programmer to remember. And so now we have discussed two arguments, and the last is the mode. So this will specify the privileges for this open file for different users. So when we were discussing about Linux terminal commands, you must have remembered that there were three types of users: as user, user group, and others. So this mode does nothing but specify. So what are the privileges? There are basic three types of privileges. Those are read, write, and execute. Read, write, and execute. There are three user types: as user, group, and others. So what is going to be set by this mode is, so we are going to specify whether those are there or not. So what we can pass as the mode is those. So these are the things that you can pass with O. With O symbol. O symbol means this symbol. This symbol. So when you do the example, you will understand how we are going to pass this one, right? So if we use this one, we say the operating system to set read, write, execute privileges for user. Use stands for user. So set read write execute privileges for group, set read write execute privileges for others. So that is, so if you issue these three arguments with O, then you will specify read write execute privileges for all users. So there is a shortcut for doing this, that is just giving 0666. If you give 0666, it is same as passing this. It is same as passing this, right? But the fact is, you have to include this one and this one also, this header file. So otherwise, it will not be able for the compiler to understand this, what is meant by this. Or otherwise, you can specify individual privileges for user. Set, for example, set write privilege for user. Now the user is identified by three characters. Here only one character and three privileges were there. Here it is the other way: one privilege, one character for privilege, and three characters for the user type. Write privilege for user, read privilege for group, execute privilege for others. So this is how you can give individual privileges. So like other system calls, it will also give -1 on error. Otherwise, it will, as I told you, it will assign the least empty file descriptor. So there are a lot of empty file descriptors, which is adjacent to the highest file descriptor which is assigned. There is a highest file descriptor which is assigned. Next to that one, it is the empty file descriptor. That is the least empty file descriptor. It will be assigned by this open system code. So if you open a file, you must close that file. So close is very easy than open. Just what you have to, there's only one argument. You just have to pass the file descriptor inside this close. And this will close the file descriptor. Otherwise, the other programs, after you finish the present programs, these file descriptors will not be released for the operating system to be allocated by other files. So you must free. If you are not using a file descriptor, then you must free it. So for that purpose, you must make sure that if you open, you must close the file descriptor. Okay, so you can see when you are not able to open. So in case this there's an error, for example, the user may not have privilege to open it. In that case, the open function will not be able to execute properly. So it will return -1. It will return -1. So in that case, so you must know how to handle errors. If you get -1, then you should know what happened. Otherwise, not knowing just an error occurred will not be a good way when you are programming. So this error, what the error occurred. Is stored in some header file. So that header file is error number. So simply you can pronounce it as error. So this one has a function called as perror. Perror. So perror. So perror will print the error which occurred, right? You can print the error using this function. So for this one, you have to include this header file. So what is this perror is going to do is, so we have to print the error. We have to pass the argument here, So that is a character. Character as the character, you can pass the file name. File name is a character. So you can pass the file name here, and it will print the error corresponding to that file. So the last encountered error will be printed to the standard error. If the standard error is also your screen, it will be shown on the screen. And this error number is stored in a variable known as this unknown. You can print this using printf function and visualize the error in case an error occurs. So that these functions will be sufficient for doing the first example that we discussed today. So we to demonstrate these functions, so we'll do an example. So it here we are asked to create a text file named doc1.txt and write the name and age, the user input using standard input, that is keyboard, to this file with possible error handling. So we have to handle the errors. If the document1.txt exists, the program should truncate it and rewrite. So we have to use that arguments, flags, appropriately and write this one, right? So we'll start programming this one. So the fact is you cannot use any Linux utilities. You have to program it using C and compile using GCC, right? And you can use only low level input output, right? Low level Unix input output functions for this. So that those are the functions that we just discussed. Okay. And one more thing to for you to remind. So from today onwards, all the lecture videos will be available through my YouTube channel. So I have created a YouTube channel for including all the lecture videos from today onwards. So you, I have included a single link in your LMS, and that will carry you to a playlist where you can watch all the operating system programming lectures that I upload. So please subscribe to the channel so that you will get updates through your email when I upload a new video. Then you will be notified automatically. So that I wanted to remind from today onwards, this video will also be available through that channel, right? Okay. So we will first change the directory to desktop. I hope you can remember these commands we discussed about 2 months ago. Right, and for this exercise, we'll just create a new directory. As with this name, so you can see in the screen a new directory was created, and we'll change the directory into that one. And for writing the programming file, we'll create a file as this one, program.c, and we'll open it using gedit. Right. So first, we have to include the header files that I specified to you before. So we need to include the universal studio. So this is the main header file which contains those low level system input output system calls. So universalstudio.h. There were more sysstat.h. So that is for specifying constants like 0666, like, and also include error number. And to get those flags specified in the open system call, you need another header file. So that is fcntl.h. And when you have an error, you need to exit from the program. That means you need to exit from the, that means terminate the program. So for terminating the program, you have some function known as exit. So that function is defined in standard library, stdlib. So this is included for that exit function. That means when you encounter an error, you need to exit or terminate the program. In that case, you need to have this standard library.h. Okay, so so these have the function definitions. So we need not to declare any function or define any function. So we'll just start from the main program. So you know the return type of main program is integer. Main, wait, no arguments. We begin and end. Return zero. Right, so better to use tabulators in your program, make it a habit. Right, so first we are, so what in the program example, we are asked to get user input for the name and age. Right, so we need to store those in some variables. So the size of the name. So when you store a string, you must specify the size. But when a person enters the name of a person can be of different size. So, but you cannot have a variable name declared. So that the program needs to allocate some memory for your variable. So if you don't specify the size of that memory, then you will get an error as segmentation fault. That means it will not be, the program or the compiler will not be able to identify what is the size of your variable, right? So because of that one, so we'll first ask the size of the name from the user. First, we'll ask the size. So we'll printf, enter size of your name. Then the user will enter the size, and we need to scan and store it in this integer variable. So it is an integer variable, so we need to use this symbol %d, and we have to pass the address of this variable, size. So it will read and store the size in this variable. So after storing the size, now you know the size of your name, then you can declare a string with this size. So now you can declare a string. So it is of type character array. String is what? A character. So we'll say name, name, and the size of this array, character array, is this size. Size of this character array is this size. And now we'll do the same thing for name. We'll ask from user what is, enter your name. And we'll give a new line here, otherwise everything will be on one line. Enter your name. And now the data type is different. It is, the data type is not a character, but it is a string. String. And string is what? A character pointer. String is a character pointer. And what is this name? So this name is a character pointer. So character pointer is an address. So you need not to specify this symbol anymore. You can just give this one as name, because name is an address. It is of data type names. This symbol's name data type is character pointer. It is an address, so you need not to give this one as and name. You can just give it as name. Okay, now we stored the name. Then we need to get the age, but we will not get it as an integer. We will get it as two characters, because we need to store this or print this in a screen, or we need to store this one in file, right? Okay, so we will get, we'll use this same. I'll just copy paste this one. Print enter your age. String, okay, before that, you need to declare the variable for age. So I declare it as size 2, because the age does not usually exceed more than two characters. So enter your age, it is also a string, and this is age. Right, so now you got the inputs from the user, and what you need to do is, now you have to open. So as there is no file as doc1, so you need to create and open and store this in your file. So how to do that? Using the open system call. So if you go back and refer the open system call, you can see the return type is integer. So it will return the file descriptor. So I describe this one. It will return the file descriptor, right? So first you need to declare. So I'll declare integer variable as file descriptor one. FD1 stands for file descriptor 1. You can call any name you want, but to identify properly, I'll issue this one as FD1, file descriptor 1, because this is what you will be returning from the open function. So open, so what is the name of the file that we asked to create? It is doc1. So doc1 we will create in the present working directory. So we will use relative addressing. So we say, in this directory, create the file known as doc1.txt. So that's the path name, first argument, relative addressing. And the second one is what? Flags. So the flags are identified in using this fcntl.h. So the flags are, so we are going to open this For what we are going to open this for writing. So we have some variables. We are opening this one for writing. So we are opening this one for write only. You can even give the read write privilege, but we'll use write only. And we need to pass if this one does not exist, create. If this does not exist, create. And we have been specifically instructed if the document exists, the program should truncate it and rewrite. So based on that requirement, we need to truncate if it does exist. Trunk. So those are the flags that you need to specify here. Then the third argument is mode. So you need to set the mode. So either you can easily use this 0666 argument to set read write execute privilege for all users, or the hard way, set read write execute privilege for user. Then odd with set read write execute privilege for group. Set read write execute privilege for others. So this will now open a file, this one, and we need to handle the error. Suppose this is not open. So that if there is an error, this FD1 will be equal to -1, because if -1 is not a valid file descriptor, because I told you upon error, this will return -1. So we can catch that error with an error code or not if this FD1 is equal to -1. So we need to write if FD1 equal -1, then we need to print the error. We'll use beer print error as the argument. You can remember we'll issue this the file name doc1.txt, and we'll print our own command. That is, file could not be open properly. Error number is, then we can print the error number. So it is of type integer. And I told you that the error number is stored, the last encountered error is stored in this error num, this head, that is defined in this header file, and that is no. And make sure you end it here. The number, then you print error. So by this time you could not open this file descriptor, then you need not to close that one. You will exit the program. This is the exit function. Because of that one, you need to include this library. And if this is not true, that is else, that means what? That means the file has been opened successfully. So we'll just print for the user to know. Printf file opened successfully. need to include them in new lines, otherwise everything will be in the same line. So if we open the file, now our next task is, so we open, then, so either we have to read from the file, or now having opened, we can write or read to file. So in this one, we are asked to write to the file. So for that one, before attempting this, you need to know another function. So we'll first finish up that function and come here. Okay, so that function is called write. Right, so this system call you need to understand before attempting that one. So if you know, understand the open system call, write system call is relatively easy than that one. So the return type is size t. So what is the size t? Size t is the number of bytes written to the file. The return, it will, this write function, the name of the function is write, it will return the number of bytes written to the file. And the first argument is this file descriptor. So what is this file descriptor? It is an open file descriptor. So for example, a file descriptor which is open using this open system call. Simple as that one. So this should be a valid file descriptor, the first argument. Then this is the file which we need to write the data to. And the second thing is called a buffer, so which is a memory. And its data type is void pointer. I mean, it is, so pointers are new or learned in basic programming in C. What are pointers? So pointers are used to store the address of a variable. So void pointer is of type data type void, and this is an address. So buffers refers to an address which contains some data. And so from the address which is pointed by this buffer, so not having the address is enough, we need to specify what size, number of bytes that we expect to write to this file. So this is the address of the buffer or the variable which contains the data that we need to write to the file, and this is the expected size. So up to this size, the content in this buffer will be written to the file. So if you specify size as 2, then 2 bytes, if I speak specifically, the first 2 bytes of this variable buffer, what is pointed by this variable buffer, will be written to the file pointed out by this file descriptor. There is a file pointed out by this file descriptor. The data, the first data pointed by this size contained in this address will be written to the file. That is the function of this write system call, and it will return the number of successful bytes written to the file. And if you get it as -1, then that means it is an error, because this either no bytes is written or a positive number of bytes are written. If you get minus 1, that means there is some error, either privileges or whatever. So we need to do error handling when we issue this command also. Okay, so we'll go here. So now we need to write to file. So we will issue this command write. Okay, we'll say integer bytes written. So byte written will contain the number of bytes written by this write command. I'll say it as one because we will have to write this twice. Integer byte written write. So what is the file descriptor? File descriptor is FD1. So this here also it should be FD1. File descriptor 1. Then you need to enter the address of the variable that this data is contained. So first we'll have to write the name. So name is stored in this one, in this address, and it its data type, you can see it as character pointer. This name is of data type character pointer. So but in this write functions definition you saw that it is of type void pointer. So you need to convert this character pointer to void pointer and give that argument here. So such a thing is known as casting or type casting. So we will cast void pointer name. So what is being done here? There is a variable with data type character pointer. You cast it to void pointer. You cast it to void pointer. That means you convert this character pointer variable into a void pointer variable type. Then the third argument is the expected size. So you know that the size, maximum size of this variable is nothing but size. Size. So the first one is okay. So as the code gets complex, if you do error handling here, I will omit error handling. But when you write your own program, I recommend you to do the error handling here also. So how to do error handling? You check whether bytes written 1 is equal to minus 1 or not. If it is equal to minus 1, you print the error and exit. Otherwise, you continue the main program. Right, so I will not use error handling here. I will just give the second write. So to get this one a little bit clear, I'll just create another buffer. Another buffer. And here to separate these two. Otherwise, this will be written at the same in one line. So character, I'll say buffer one. Of size 5. I can initialize the buffer like this one. I'll say age is, and I think it is size 6. So not only the values that you obtain from the user, you can write any memory from any memory to a file using this write function. It needs not to be a user input. right? Okay, so integer bytes written is write. We are going to write the same file. So pointer, a cast operation, and we are going to cast this buffer one, and the expected size is 6. And then we are going to write this age. And then we are going to write this age. Bytes written 3. Right, for the same file descriptor. Now we are going to write this age. Pointer is of type character pointer. Cast it to void pointer. Then the expected size is here. You can see the size of this age is 2, only 2 characters. Right. So to demonstrate the error handling, I will do error handling only for this one. Right. So if bytes written 3 is equal to -1, that is in case of an error, we need to print the error. So I'll just copy paste these two. So this time it is not opening. This writing. If it happens, you exist. Otherwise, you can just print a message that printf written to file successfully. Sorry, this should be inside else, otherwise it will always come in. So this should be inside an else block. If this is in error, this will be done. Otherwise, if it is success, it'll print this one. And the most important thing is you need to close. So you saw how this close function a moment ago. So in close function, you need to pass the file descriptor that you want to close. So close file descriptor 1. Otherwise, the integer which is used as this file descriptor will not be able to be used by the operating system for any other file. So we need to free this file descriptor. Right, so that's it. So we'll see whether this program can be compiled. -O, need to create an executable file. Okay, we have forgotten to include, so this printf scanf, so they are defined in stdioh. You learned this one in programming in C. Okay, still. There's an error here when opening set. Here I have forgotten I. So this should be in order: read, write, execute. Here I have used in another, the other order: read, write, execute. Okay, now it compiled successfully. So we'll just execute and see. So first you have to enter the size of your name. My name is 9 letters. So you specify your size of your name. So if I go to this directory now, so this is the working directory of this program that now I am working. If I go to this directory, you can see only the program.c and exe.x are there, but we will see after we give this one. So now I'm going to give my age. Okay, we get the output as file open successfully, return to file successful. Then that means there hasn't been any kind of error which had occurred. That means the program had come here, and all of these had been executed, and there hadn't been an error here. This has been positive, so it has been written to file successful. We'll see whether there is a file. Yes, now there is a file. We'll see whether our content has been written or not. Yes, name, and this is the thing that we printed manually, and this is H. So that is how you can use system calls to write to a file. That's how you use system calls to write to a file. I hope this is clear to you. In case you have any questions, you can ask. Right. So, okay, now we'll move forward. Now we'll study about the read. Now we wrote to a file, then the read is similar. If you understood write, then read is nothing. So it is very similar. The arguments are very similar, almost similar. So the first argument is file descriptor, buffer, size. The difference is only the function. So this one will return the number of bytes read. So here in the write, it writes from the buffer to the file. So in here, the read, low level read system call will read from the file pointed out by this file descriptor to the buffer or the memory specified, I mean addressed by this address up to a size, specified this size. So there is a memory. You read from the file to this memory. You read from file to this memory. That is the function of this read system call. Very similar to write system call, so there is nothing much. Only the function is different. The other way of write. Okay, so having understood that one, we can demonstrate this read also like this. So upon failure, this will also return -1 just like other system calls. If it was not able to read, it will return -1. Otherwise, it will return 0 or positive based on the number of bytes read from the file. Okay. We'll go for the second example. The second example is to implement the Linux utility copy of cat command. So in Linux utility, it was just a single command. Copy the content of one file into another file. Now he had to use the error handling also. With possible error handling, we have to copy content from one file into another file called doc2.txt. So now we already have this file. We will copy the content of that file into this file. Using the low level system of input output functions, read and write. Using read and write. Okay, I will just replace this file, but I recommend you to use a separate file when you write. For demonstration purpose only, I will just edit in this file. So in this program, no need to get user input likewise. So I'll just comment out this code. And the first file descriptor is the same. We need to open the file descriptor. And this time we are not going to open it for writing. We are going to open it for read only. Because we are going to read from doc1 and write to doc2. So as we are going to read from doc1, we'll use this flag, read only. And if it does not exist, create, but it is already existing. And we are now not going to truncate. May I use append here? So just to demonstrate that 0666 also working, I will pass that argument here. Right, so error handling is same. If we cannot open the file, it will be there. We'll say not file to be specific, we say doc1. Open successfully. Then we need not to have any of this. We'll keep only one. We will declare a memory like this one. We'll say buffer one. We'll say buffer one and specify a size. So we need to specify the size of this buffer. We may say so that one, this file contained about 18 characters. So we'll store that character there. So we'll pass 18 here. Size of this buffer is 18. Now we need not to write but read from this file. So we have the privilege read from this file. So we'll say integer bytes read. Bytes read is equal to read. Read from the file pointed by this file descriptor, FD1. Then we'll cast this buffer to void pointer. It may work even without void pointer, but to be specific, we'll cast this to void pointer. Buffer one, then the size of this buffer, that is 18. So what will this do? This will read from the file pointed by this one and store in the memory pointed by this one. That is in buff one, it will read up to 18 bytes. So now we will replace this by bytes read. So we'll do the error handling also. Bytes read, same document. We'll say couldn't read. If it couldn't read, we'll go into exit. Otherwise, read from file successfully, then this one is also okay. Then we need to close this file descriptor. Now we don't need that file descriptor anymore, right? Now to write to a new file, we need to create another file descriptor and we need to open that file. So we need to copy this one into doc2. So we need to create. So integer file descriptor 2, open another file in this one as in the same directory as doc2. If you want, you can give the exact address of the place that you want to copy this file. You can even pass the exact address here. So, or use the relative addressing. So if you want to create this in the previous directory, you can use double dot doc2.txt. But as the question asking us to create in the present directory, I will use doc2.txt. So you can specify any place you want. You can just try on your own this example, and you can pass any argument here and check whether I'm telling the truth or not. Okay, so that is the first argument. Then as second argument, you should give these flags. So for what purpose are we opening this file descriptor? We are opening this for writing. Open for write only. And as this is not there, we need to create it. Create, and we'll give a truncate. We again and again give this one. We need to truncate the existing contents of the file doc2. Okay, having this one, then I'll say, to demonstrate the individual privilege assignment, I will use set. So we need to write. So I will assign write privilege only to the user. So I am a user. So I should be able to write to this file. I will not use. Give any other privilege to other users such as user group or any other user. Just I will give the privilege for me for writing, and it is open for write only. So, and there's a small problem. If you use this write only, then you will not be able to read the contents of this file, right? So then I will not be able to show this file to you, whether it has been successfully written or not. For that purpose only, I will change this one to read write. Otherwise, I will not be able to show it to you. So I will give separate two privileges for user set. Also the read privilege for user. So I'm going to give both write and read privilege to use. Okay. So now we need to do the error handling again. If the 2 is equal to minus 1. Just copy paste to save time, and adjust the content as appropriate. So now this is not the document one, it is document 2.txt. So couldn't now we'll say open or create. Don't open or create file, because we are here opening, giving the open system call. So we will say we couldn't open or create, and press and give the error number. Otherwise, if it is open, we will printf. We'll print in a new line. Doc2.txt opened successfully. Right. So we need to do otherwise. So we need to use else. So you, better to use this indenting, otherwise you will miss out which statement you are going to use. Right, so if you open it without an error, then you can write to it. So from which one are you going to write? You are, so you previously read to this buffer using this read command. Now the contents are in this buffer, so you can use the same buffer for write. You previously read to this buffer, then you can write to this buffer. So I'll say integer bytes written is equal to write. So now for which file descriptor are we? So now the file descriptor one is closed. So here we read from the file descriptor. If we were able to read successfully from the file descriptor, we closed the file descriptor here. Now the file descriptor one is not longer there. Now we need to write to file descriptor two, which we opened a moment ago, this one. New file doc2.txt. So for that file we need to write from this buffer, at buffer, the same buffer that we read the contents from the file one, doc1.txt. We read to this buffer one. Now we need to write from this buffer up to the same size. And we have to do the error handling again. Same thing we have to do again. Can't help. So we need to specify bytes written equal minus 1. Else this. If it was written to file, if it wasn't written to file, you will get minus 1. So in that case, we have to print the error and exit. Couldn't we say write to file and exit. Terminate the program. Otherwise, we'll print written to file successfully. Then the most important thing, you need to close the existing file descriptor, that is file descriptor 2. So I think that's it. So now we opened one file, then read from that file to a buffer, then from that buffer we wrote to another file which was opened here, and at last close the file descriptor. So the file compiled successfully, so we'll execute. So we get some messages. First, the doc one was opened successfully. Then it from that one read successfully. Then doc two was opened successfully. Then written to document two successfully. So we'll check whether there's a file known as doc two. Yes, inside doc two there is a small problem. Month age is 28, and there is an empty character. That means I have miscounted. So that means from this file there are only 17 characters are there. I have issued as 80. So in such case, the size that we had read from the buffer exceeds the contents of the file. So always when you read from a file, the size, the maximum size that you read from the file to the buffer should be lesser or equal to the maximum number of bytes contained in the file. Otherwise, unknown characters will be read from that file. So we need to specify this as 70. He also changed the size to 70. So what the size that you read should be less than or equal to the maximum number of bytes contained in the file. Okay, now we'll see the contents of document 2. Now it's okay. Now it is exactly equal to 70. So I hope this example is clear too. So I use here 0666. So there was no any error. So it is a shortcut method other than using these modes. So in the high level model is even easier than this low level model. So what we will be discussing next week will be the high level model. It is even simpler than this low level model, right? So there's some more content that you need to cover regarding file input and output. That is, when you read from a file, so there is something known as file offset. File offset. So in the previous example, you wrote the name first. You wrote the name first, then you again manually wrote some letters to the file. Then again you wrote the age after that one. So when this write system call was executed, first the name was written, then at the end of that writing, the second writing was begun. So what I am telling is, so now, so So consider this just this demonstration. So this is a file. So there is a cursor in this file. So cursor is the pointer that we type. So the point that we write to this file, this display, this cursor is the pointer which specifies the point where that we write to file, that we write to this file. So if the cursor is here, if I say writing this file one, so this is the first write that we give. This is just an example. So if assume this is the first write that we give from the write system call, okay, this one was executed, then after that the second write command will begin from the point that the previous write command was finished. So that means there is something known as file offset, which is similar to the cursor of this typing, right? Just similar to what I am typing here. When when it is written to a file, there is some concept known as file offset, which is a pointer to where the file is read or written. So when we are writing, at the end of the writing, the file, at the beginning of the writing, the file offset will be here. At the end of the writing, the file offset will be here, so that the next write operation will begin from here. So this is the second write operation. So each write function will update the file offset. It will be at the last byte of the write operation. Similarly, the read operation is also operating in the same manner. For example, in the beginning of a read operation, the file offset is at the beginning of the file. For example, if we are going to issue a command like this, read 17 bytes, then at the end of that read operation, this file offset will be at the 17th byte. So this is the 0th byte, first byte, second byte, third byte. Likewise, it will come up to the 17th byte. 17 byte, and it will be stopping here. Then if you give another read command, then the second read command will not begin from here. The second read command will start from this point and move on. So that's why there is known as the concept called file offset is there, just like the cursor. You can imagine file offset as a cursor. Right. So the read and write function will update this file offset sequentially. Sequentially means one after another. So when at the end of the file, for example, if it is a write operation, at the end of that write operation, the file offset will be incremented by this number of bytes. The file offset will be incremented by this amount of bytes at a read or write operation which you specify, this size. So it is sequential, and there is a function which is specifically there to change the file offset manually. So that function is known as lsync. So that is the function that we are going to discuss now. So that is known as lsync. So lsync is also defined in universalstudio.h. So this description says the one that I told you, that each read and write operation update the file offset sequentially, right? Okay, so this is how this lsync is defined. So the name of the function is LC. So its first argument is the file descriptor. So this will point to the file that we are going to call this LSeq function. Then the second argument is the offset, file offset. And third argument is called bends. So we need to understand what is this offset and what is this bends. So bends will specifically change the file offset. That means the current file of position of the current file offset. This bends can take three values, either seek set, seek current, or seek end. So this is an integer. So if it is an integer, it is 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, and these values are defined in fcntl.h. If you cannot remember 0, 1, 2, you can remember it as seek set, seek current, seek end. So what is this seek set? We can set the file offset to the beginning of the file. So if you set 0 or seek set as the bends, then the file, the present file offset will be changed to the beginning of the file. If you set seek current, the current file offset will not be changed. It will be exactly at the point where it is at the present. For example, if the file offset is now at the 18th byte, after some read and write operations, if the file offset is now at the moment at the 18th byte, if you give seek current, it will not change the position of the file offset. That is the purpose of seek current. It will not change the file offset. And the third argument is seek end. It will move the file offset to the end of the file, where the last byte of the file is contained. Last byte of the file is contained. Seek end. Right. So this will change the file offset either to the beginning of the file, the current position of the file offset without changing, or to the end of the file. And what is this offset? And this offset is measured with respect to the bends. With respect to the bends. For example, if bends is seek set and offset is 5, then that means 5 bytes from the beginning of the file. This LSeq will change the file offset to 5 bytes from the beginning of the file if this bends is seek set and offset is 5. And another example, if this offset is 5 and bends is seek current, the present file offset will be incremented by 5. Or increased by 5. That means at the moment, if the present file offset is at 18th byte, if you give here seek current and 5, then the file offset will be increased by 5 with respect to the present position. That means the present file offset will be 18 plus 5, 23. File offset will move to 23. And last example, if this bends is seek end, that means end of the file, and this offset is 5, then it will move to the end of the file and offset will be located 5 bytes away from that end of the file. So that is how you can change the file offset using the LSeq. and the return type is of t, the actual offset which this lseek offset the file. Actual offset this lseek offset the file. Okay, so that's how we can use this lseek. So to demonstrate this one, we'll do an example. So we'll do the third one. We are asked to write a program to read 15th byte to 30th byte and 40th byte to 50th byte from document 1.txt and write to document 2.txt. We are asked to read from 15th byte to 30th byte then 40th byte to 50th byte. Okay, so we'll I will modify the same one, but you can create another one. To save time, I will modify the same file. So we had written a program to read from file to another file. So I will just modify this one. So to identify the byte position, I will specify this one with the first byte 0, second byte 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this is the 10th byte. This is the 9th byte. This is the 8th byte likewise. So first byte is 0. So likewise, we should have 50 bytes. So now 20 bytes, 30 bytes, 40 bytes, 50 bytes. So 50th byte is 9. 40th byte is 9. Likewise, you can imagine. So I'm writing like this to identify that we are writing the correct byte. That's why. Otherwise, you can enter any type of string here. I'm just using this one to demonstrate we are going to write the exact byte. Okay, so we open a file, and now in this case, we need to create two buffers to read from file. First one is buffer one, 15th to 30th byte. 15th to 30th, that means 15th to 30th byte, there are 16 bytes. So this buffer one size should be 16. And before reading, so if you just give the read function, it will read from beginning of the file. But now we need not to read from the beginning, we need to read from 15th byte. So we need to issue lseek command. Lseek, the file descriptor is file descriptor one. We need to change the offset of this file. We need to offset from seek set. Seek set is the beginning of the file. We need to offset from the beginning of the file. If we offset 0, that is the first byte. If we offset 1, that is the second byte. So if we offset 14, that means we will be pointing to the 15th byte. If you offset 14, we will be pointing to the 15th byte. So starting from the 15th byte, we need to read 16 bytes. We need to read 16 bytes. So 15 to 30th, there will be 16 bytes. At the end of this operation, the file offset will be 31. File offset will be 31 at the end of this operation. So in the question, we are asked to, we are asked to read from 40th to 50th byte. So the present offset is 31. So to get the offset to 40th byte, again we'll issue an lseek operation for this file. Now we will measure the file offset from the current position. Seek current. The current position is 31. From the current position, you need to move 9 bytes to come to the 40th byte. Okay, at the end of this lseek function, now you will have come to the 40th byte. You have come up to the 40th byte. So first you need to create a buffer to store that value. Buffer and the buffer size should be 40th to 50th byte. There are 11 bytes. So the buffer size should be 11. And the name should be another name. I'll name it as buffer 2. So for the buffer 2, you need to, so I'll specify it as the bytes red 2. Read 2 equal read from file descriptor 1 pointer buffer 2, and the size, expected size, is 11, 40th to 50th byte. It will change the file descriptor from 40 to 51. At this point, the file descriptor will be, sorry, not the file descriptor, file offset. File offset will be now 51. No, after that one, we don't bother about the file offset. So after that one, so now we have read 15 to 30th byte, and then 40th to 50th byte, and the results are stored in buffer 1 and buffer 2. And I will just modify this one as read 2. To be precise, you need to check the error handling for byte read also, but I will omit this one. I will just check for byte read 2. Couldn't read from, okay, read from file successfully. Then after that one, we need to close the file descriptor 1. Then we need to open the file descriptor like this one. And then we need to write to this file. Okay, now we have to issue two write commands from buffer 1. Also we need to write from buffer 2. Also we need to write. I'll just check this for bytes written 2. I will omit bytes written 1. So this will be buffer 1 of size 16, and the second one will be buffer 2 of size 11. We are writing to file descriptor 2. If bytes written 2 is minus 1, okay, this one. And so now we have successfully written the program. We'll need to check whether it is working. Compile. Okay, it gave success messages. We need to verify whether functionally it is okay. Okay, so we were asked to read from the document 1, 14, 15 to 30th byte. So we'll just open document 1 also. 15 to 30th byte. So this is the 15th byte because it is containing 4. 4 means if it is 0, it is first. If it is 1, it is second. Likewise, if it is 4, when it comes to here, it is 15th byte. So you should write from 4 to this one. up to 30th byte. So 30th byte is 9. 30th byte is 9. So have we written it? So 14th byte to 30th byte. Yes, 30th byte is this 9. Then we need to write from 40th byte to 50th byte. 40th byte is this one, this 9. 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50. Beginning with 9 and ending with 9. So it is okay, no? So this is up to here, it is 15 to 30th. From here to here, 40th to 50th. So we have written it perfectly. So if I remind you back, what we did was, we use LSeq to change the file offset. So we use LSeq here. Before reading, we change the offset to 15 byte here, using LSeq. How we change? Starting from the beginning of the file, we counted up to 15 bytes and located the file offset there. And from beginning from there, we read 16 bytes. So the file offset will be set to 31. Then after that, starting from the 31st byte, we incremented the file offset 9 bytes, resulting coming the file offset pointing to 40th byte. 40th byte, then starting from 40th byte, we read 11 bytes coming to 50th byte. 50th byte reading, and then the file offset will be set to 51 after reading 11. Okay, so that's what we did here. That's how you use LSeq to change the file offset and read the bytes that you own, right? So only one thing remaining to study in today's lesson, that is change mode. So CHMOD or change mode function you learned in the Linux utilities also. There is a separate Linux utility command for changing the user privileges. So similar to that one, in low level input output also, you have a function called change mode. This function. So it is having two arguments as the path name, that is the file path name, and the mode. So mode is nothing but the exact mode that you specified for file opening. So what is mode? This is the mode. What were the modes? These were the modes. Read, write, execute, privileges for users, user groups, and others. These are the privileges that you can change using the change mode command. So using the change mode command, you can change the permissions for a file, but the important thing is it should be a closed file. It should be a closed file. You cannot do the change mode to an open file. That's why you have to specify the path name here. Otherwise, if it was an open file, you could have passed the file descriptor here. So you don't pass the file descriptor here because the change mode is specified for a closed file, right? So to change the privileges of a closed file. So for demonstrating this one, we'll do the example 4 and example 5 I give you as a homework. This is similar to the example 4 where you have to change the read and write privileges. Okay, we'll do the example 4. So we have to create and open a file called doc3 with read, write, execute privileges. And then we have to close it. Close it. Then using the change mode, we have to change the privileges to read only. Read only. Without opening, that means using a change mode. Then we need to open the document 3 as a read-only file and write a programming array handling to write a sentence. So we change the privilege as read-only. So we cannot write to a file with read-only. So if you specify read-only, you cannot write. So we have to use error handling to write a sentence to it with error handling. So you should get an error when we attempt to write to it. Okay, we'll just modify this program to get that one. So I'll just use the same one and create a document as doc 3. And before creating this one, I will just use the change mode command to change the privileges of this file. doc3.txt. To I'll change. So we are asked to give read write privileges for user. Read write execute privilege for user. Set read write execute privilege for group. Set read write execute privileges for others. This is how you use the change mode command. So file descriptor 1. Now we'll open doc 3. So first we are asked to open it with all privileges. Create with read write execute privileges. So no need to specify it as read only. We'll specify it as read write. So if it does not exist, create. If it exists, we'll truncate, and all privileges are given. Now this is doc 3. Okay, so we are going to open this one again about 2 times. So I'll say this one first time. It could not be opened for the first time. So here document 3 opened successfully. Okay, and these are not necessary for this time. I just comment out them. And so what we are asked to do here is, first, we need to close this file descriptor. So now we create a file and we need to close it. Then we have to change mode to read privileges without opening it. Right, we will do that. So we need to close the file descriptor. We need to close the file descriptor. And it is FB1. And we need to change the mode here. Change mode of document 3.txt to read only privilege. So we need to set read privilege for user. Set read only privilege for group. Set read only privilege for others. Okay, we set. Then we are asked to open another file. Open another file descriptor for the same file with read only. Right, so we need not to have this one because we are not writing here. No. So we will omit this one. We need to remove, not that one. this packet. We will indent it back here. Okay, so read from file, we need to close. Then we need to, not here close, so this is from the previous one. Okay, we are asked to create, open document 3 as read only. Read only document. We are asked to open document 3 as read only. How to open document 3 as read only? We need to create another file descriptor, open document 3 as not as read write, because we should open it as read only, because we have only read privilege assigned to users. We changed the privilege to read only here, even though we created it for read write execute privilege in the beginning. We changed the privilege here after closing this file descriptor. So we need to open it using read only. So as we open it read only, you cannot create or truncate. There's no meaning in creating or truncate if you open read only. So this will be same as this three, because privilege is read. Read privilege for all users. It should be same as this privilege. File descriptor 2, if it is, if you can open it, you can open it here. Otherwise you will get an error here. Couldn't open or create file. Okay, here. Okay, if it is open correctly, doc3.txt opened successfully. And if it is open, we are asked to attempt to write to it. Okay, this is a good example of that done. So we'll say character of 1, 9. I'll just give my name. Right, so bytes written 1, write to file descriptor buff 1, the size is 9. Now we are going to attempt to write to this one. But actually you can see here, you cannot write because you have opened it as read only. With read only privilege, you cannot write. So this should definitely give you an error. This should definitely give you an error. And you should get as doc3 couldn't write to file. You should get this error definitely. You cannot get written to file, and you should get exit. Okay, so if you wrote this program, get this program correctly, can compile it here and can execute, you can see doc3 open successfully. Bad file descriptor open successfully, couldn't write to file. What is this? Bad file descriptor. Couldn't file to, error number is 9. So doc3 opened successfully means it came here. It came here. And couldn't write to file properly means here. So we come to write operation here. No? So that means it has passed all of these. It has passed all of these things. It has been opened, and it has been changed to read only privilege, and it has come to here to writing, but you cannot write because it is read only. So you will get a message as couldn't write to file properly. So that's true. That means your privileges has been successfully changed. So we'll see here doc3. There's a file called doc3. It is read only. If you try to write something, and if you try to save is not alive because it is read only. So that's what I wanted to demonstrate you about change in the privileges. So that's about low level system input outputs. I hope the content of today's lecture is clear to you, and if you have any questions, you can ask now or email me later. If you have any questions, you can ask now, of course. If you don't have any questions, you can leave. And don't forget to subscribe to the my YouTube channel, which I will upload this video also. Right, so it seems that you don't have any questions. So thank you. We'll meet next week.